Good morning, church. We're excited to worship this morning. Find your seats, but stand with us.
Find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Come have your way among us. We welcome you.
Short video for you.
Not everybody gets walk-up music like I do, but thank you for that. Good morning, church. My name is Gail Cobb, and I am the newly hired Children's Ministry Director. And thank you. And welcome to our live stream community who's watching us this morning. If you are new to our church, was that me? If you are new to our church, there is a connection card in the back of the chairs in front of you that you can fill out. Remember, our mission here is to love Jesus, to be a church that loves Jesus, makes disciples, and serves our community. Okay, so thumbs up if you are excited about VBS. Thumbs up.
Oh, I saw the thumbs up. So does this mean it's time to come to VBS?
Well, it's not quite time to come, but it is time where we have officially got the registration open for Bible school.
Well, just so you know, if you learn about a little scuba diving, this means ascend up, not okay.
Oh,
whoops. But if you want them to say okay to your buddy, you go like this.
Oh.
But if it's to your captain in the boat, get everybody to do this.
Okay, okay, all right. Okay, so I invited my little diving friends here to let you all know that registration is open for VBS. There is a QR code here that will take you right to the link that you can register either as a participant or as a helper, a volunteer. There was also a link in this week's newsletter. Please be talking to your friends and your neighbors, giving them personal invitations. In just a minute, I'll share what we did yesterday. At the end of service, I'm gonna be out there with this sand bucket here with these little leftover postcards that we had for anybody who wants to take them, give them to your friends and neighbors, invite them. We want kids here so desperately for Bible school. Word of mouth and those personal invitations, that is the most successful avenues for getting kids here. Thank you to all of you who have already let me know you'd like to volunteer. You can also go and sign up. For those of you who aren't able to help directly with kids, though, don't worry, there's lots of ways that you can help. And so more information about ways that you can help will be coming out soon. And I'm so excited to partner with all of you, with my diving friends. Okay, so who's ready to help spread the word about VBS? Give me a thumbs up. Oops, wait, I mean, give me an okay sign that you're ready to help spread the word. All right, thank you. Well, as many of you know, yesterday we had a float in the parade promoting our upcoming Vacation Bible School. And here's just a few pictures of the float that we made. We had 20 people help either with creating the float or who walked in the parade, handing out things. A huge thank you to Trish Woods, who was the creative mind behind all of this. We could not have done this without her. So thank you very much for everybody that came out and helped pass out and get the word out. It was a hot day, but we had lots of fun squirting people with squirt things, and bubbles, and we just had all kinds of fun. So, all right, well, if you're interested in being part of the Rwanda team, there is a meeting, and I think I skipped. I got to go back here. Oh, you came with me. Oh, you're good, Sherry. Thank you. If you're interested in being part of the Rwanda team, there's going to be a meeting on June 30th after the service in the fellowship hall. So please RSVP key to the church if you would like to be a part of that. Okay, and then we'll go back to the one that I skipped. Thank you. Many of you know that we partner with a homeless ministry. If you would like to be a part of the ministry by giving snack and water donations, or you're interested in joining the street team who deliver those needed items to people in need, also please contact the church office. There is going to be a women's brunch up at, on July 10th up at Covenant Hills Camp. You can register online if you would like to be a part of that. And then the nominating team announcement. The next three Sundays, so counting today, June 23rd, next three Sundays was a while ago. So it says the 16th, the 23rd, and the 30th, so really today and next Sunday, we will be accepting nominations for the leadership team and the nomination team. We have a table set up in the foyer for this process. Please note that to be eligible to submit a vote, you must be a member of Williamson Free Methodist. Nominees must also be a member, and we will have membership lists available for your review. An election will be held Sunday, July 14th, at the society meeting that's following worship. Okay. And one more thing. There are four different ways that you can give. You can give online. You can give at the church. There are some offering plates in the back. You can send it in the mail, or you can go through the church center app. So at this time, we are going to do a celebration and some announcements about the Navigators 2-7 class.
But before that, do we know why scuba divers fall over backwards into the water?
Is this a joke? Of course. Okay. See, I taught third grade for 23 years. You would think I would be able to come up with this answer, but I got nothing.
If they fell forward, they'd still be in the boat. Sometimes it's that simple.
Sometimes it's just the simplest of things, right?
Sometimes that simple.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, you can use that.
Okay, perfect.
Hey, listen, we're going to talk about Navigators 2-7, the class that has been going on for a couple years now. It is a discipleship growth class. It is for everybody. It is for the new beginner Christian. It is for even the one who's exploring Christianity. It's for those who've been a Christian for 20, 30, 40 years. There is truth, and there is truth, and there is truth that is built into these classes. And when we know truth, it just crushes the lies that we're surrounded with, and it gives us so much more to build our lives on. We're proud to make that a kind of an ongoing class. I've had the chance to lead it a couple of times, still learning. We have two different classes that are going currently. One just finished. The third book, we're going to recognize them just here in a second. And then there's another class that have gone through book one and book two, and they'll finish book three in the fall. So, if you have not participated, there's going to be more opportunities starting in the fall. And then again, the first book is scheduled to start again in the first of the year. So a couple of opportunities, we'll keep you posted on that. Take a quick moment before we recognize though that those that just finished book three. If you have participated in Navigators 2-7 here, somewhere else, anywhere in your lifetime, would you please just stand? I want to see all the people here that have been in the Navigators 2-7. Yeah, some people just a long, long time ago, and they will still stand witness. Thank you so much for standing. Appreciate it. Look around you. There's a lot of people that have done it and who can answer questions. But this morning, we want to recognize some individuals that have completed all three books. I'm gonna let Gail tell you about them and go from there.
Yeah, I'm good. Okay. So we had 11 people stick with us through the entire year from September 17th through just last week, June 16th. They completed all three workbooks in the 2-7 series. So I'm gonna ask whoever was able to be here to come up front and stand right here, please. And not able to be with us today is Robin Cool, Darren Cobb, Amanda Moran, and Candy Giovanni. You guys can, Tim, it's okay, you can stand here because you get to microphone afterwards. So if you guys want to just stand down here. Yes.
I'll come up.
Oh, he wants, okay, he's going to come up later. All right. Okay, all right. I would like you all to hear what it is that they and myself have accomplished, because I crazily led this group, whatever reason I might be crazy, because it was you guys, or it was, you know, I had never taken the class, so I learned right along with them and grew right along with them. But they now have a regularity in scripture memory and have now memorized at least 17 verses. They have a regularity in their quiet time, reading scripture with an eye for marking, recording, and responding back to God in prayer. They have a regularity in Bible study. They have completed 17 topical question and answer Bible studies. They each presented their My Story, which is their salvation story, which they wrote out and were able to give in under 4 minutes. So if anybody has 4 minutes, wants to ask them to share their testimony, they are prepared and ready to go. They practiced explaining the gospel using the illustration, the bridge illustration. They have discussed ways that they can meditate on scripture. They have discussed ways to recognize and set priorities in their life. They have all persevered and made a wonderful investment in their own lives, and I am so proud of each of them. If you had asked many of them at the beginning of the class in September, they would have told you that there was no way that they would have been able to accomplish all of the things that I just read to you, but they all did. At our last class last week, I asked them, we kind of debriefed, what did you get mostly out of this class? What were some of your takeaways? And here are some things that they said. They said they now have a very clear way to present the gospel. They have a regularity in their quiet time with God. They were able to memorize scripture, because some of us didn't think we could do that anymore. They said they had a safe place where they could share what God has been speaking to them in their lives and able to share that out. They loved the rich discussions that we had when we shared out our daily quiet time, what we got out of their scripture reading. Another thing was they felt like a little bit of a relief that they learned that they just really have to be seed planters and God will do the rest of the work. But if they're faithful in just identifying with Christ and having their salvation story ready to go, that they will be able to be used. So if you are thinking about being discipled so that you can go out and disciple others, you could talk to me, you could talk to any of these people that you see, or also the people that I read off. And I just want to just say their names, because I know when I'm sitting out there, I always want to know who it is that's up there. So this is Tim Hollisey, Brian Durkee, Denise Durkee, Holly Cobb, Martha Vogel, and Kate Larson. Okay. And so I've asked Tim if he would come and share a few words about what this experience has meant to him.
Cool. Thank you. And on behalf of the whole class, we want to thank Gail. Just could not ask for a more wonderful teacher. So, yeah, I'm new to the church, been here about 2 years. And when I started, I was coming to church, but I really didn't know a lot of you yet, and I was just kind of looking for that opportunity. I knew I had a lot to learn. I had never done a Sunday school before church class. This was my first class, and I figured, I figured it'd be a deep Bible study, something like this, real intellectual. And lucky for me, it was not that. It was just more about fellowship. And if you know me, you know fellowship. Some might say a little too much, but just hearing how the Lord is working in everybody in this church's lives every day just made such a huge impact on me. And hearing the real story, testimony of folks in the class, the wisdom that came out, and you can just see how the Lord had worked in their life throughout their entire lives. So getting to know people on that deeper level was just a huge thing for me. And I'd really like to pay that forward. So starting in the fall, I will be leading a class. If you're like me, you might have a project going on. So I just want to put this out here. How many guys have a project going on for the summer? Yeah, our wives might say too many projects. But one of the things that makes projects going, makes projects easier is when you have a group to do it with. I'm blessed to have a great group of friends. We do a lot of stuff together. We encourage each other, and that just makes the load a little easier. And Christ is asking us to do something. He's asking us to die to sin and live for us. And that's a lot easier when you're doing it with somebody else. And so if you're in that point in your life, maybe you're a new Christian, maybe you've been a Christian for a while and you're just looking to change something, this class is a great way to do that. It brings you together with people for a longer period of time, allows you to really build up habits. It's not a 5-week thing. You get to really do things over and over again, pray every day, read the Bible every day. And that's how Jesus can transform your life. So I'd love to see as many people as possible this fall. Thanks again.
Thank you. Thank you, Gail. Thank you to your leadership and your husband for taking on that class and for transferring, bringing up another leader. If you're at all have any questions, and feel free to ask. But we're encouraging everybody at some point in time to plug in. Hey, even a second time, do a refresher course. It's good, right? Very good. Thank you very much. Back to music.
Well, God is up to a lot of things, and I've already heard amazing stories this morning and even before service, just how God is answering our prayers. So we're going to go into a time of worship, and feel free to stand, please, with us. And I'm just going to invite this next song. Let's praise Him. And as we sing this, I'm going to invite the woman, follow me, and sing out, follow me, please. And then the men, will you follow Jeremiah for this first song? All right. Sing this again, see if we can get our voices louder to Him. Here we go. I will bow down.
In desperation,
I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my name. That sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip. there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. God, you are my living hope.
Let's sing out to him one more time.
I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will give you
We thank you for this time that we get to worship you. And the key is we get to. Thank you for loving us, Lord. Pray for Al as he brings the words you have laid on his heart, Lord. Keep our hearts open to hear what you have for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church family. Good morning, online church family. If you are a guest this morning, my name's Leon. I'm part of the pastoral staff of this amazing church that is filled with so many amazing people who have this servant's heart and just an encouragement day in and day out, week in and week out. And so I just want to say thank you, Lord, for how good you are to us every single week. And I want to go ahead and take some time just to pray for a few people and give praise for a few different things. There are these moments where the hand of God is evident and working and protecting, and it's just those moments that we have to stop and we have to say, Lord, thank you. And a lot of times we might just be like, oh, maybe this is just a coincidence, maybe this is just happens to be this way. And there are these moments we just need to acknowledge, like, God is good and God protects. So the first praise I want to give is for Mark Fulton. I don't know where he's at. I'm not going to call him out. He's back there. And so this is a praise. Like, we're going to be praying for his quick and speedy recovery. But this man, one, I'm jealous of him because he has a motorcycle, and which is super cool. But also, motorcycles are dangerous. And he just happened to be out riding. And he was going down, you know, Hazlitt Road and being very observant. And deer come running out. He happened to not have a helmet on at that time. And when he goes ahead and he sees a little bit of an opening where the deer are kind of running, he's like, oh, there's that spot. I'm going to try to squeeze through that right there. And like, if you know deer, you love them and you already hate them when they're on the road. So he is almost about to squeeze through and a deer just runs and clips him, and he clips it and he's tumbling. No helmet. He hits his head. He has 3 broken bones in his foot, 7 broken ribs, a punctured lung. He has this road rash on his head. And the speed that he was going, if you have ever had a motorcycle before, I've had a motorcycle, and if you even understand, like, the danger it is to be going 45 miles an hour, 50 miles an hour, 55 miles an hour, like, it's unreal to be able to walk away with just a few broken bones and some scratches and to be here. So God protected his life in that moment, and I just want to praise God for that. So please give the Lord a round of applause. Carol Dickinson, we have been praying for you, and the tests come back negative for cancer. Praise God. Praise God. So there are just these moments, right, where God is working in our church family. They're working. God's working in our life. I just want to stop and I want to acknowledge that. But I also just want to pray for some of those who are not with us this morning, but they have some things going on physically. And also I just want to pray for Ian as you go out tomorrow, right? All right, so Ian Young, he's joined the service. He's going to be shipping out tomorrow. I want to pray for protection over him. I want to just praise God, and I want to pray for some of these people who are in our church family before we get going. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your protection. We thank you for your grace. Lord, I'll be the first to admit that quite often I take life for granted. I take the breath in my lungs for granted. There are so many things, Lord, that we could be upset about day in and day out. There's so much more to praise you for and to be thankful for. So I praise you for Mark. I praise you for the fact that he just walked away from that crash and that your protection was over him. I pray for a speedy recovery over his body. I pray for a continued cover to protection over Carol and working with the doctors, Lord, to continue to help her with the sores in her mouth, Lord. And I just pray for Ian as he ships off, Lord, tomorrow, that you would continue to work in his life, that he would stay focused on you, Jesus. We thank you for all those who are struggling that we could come to you in this moment and pray for. Pray for Mike Shikaski. Pray for Mike McNeely. And we pray for all those, Lord, that we haven't said in this moment. Lord, that you'd just be working. Joe Showerman, Lord. Just so many people, Lord. And we know that even in these difficult moments, you're working, you're doing something. So Jesus, we thank you. It's in your mighty name that we pray. Amen. So I'm going to go ahead and be a little bit transparent. I function better by just being transparent. It might seem cooler today outside, but it is hotter inside. And I'm already sweating. I knew it was going to happen. I'm like Bobby Knight coaching inside of a sauna. I'm just like, dude, this is a day where it's hot in here. And hey, I'm just going to deal with it. So throughout the sermon, if I have to go ahead and jump for some real hydration, just extend me some grace, because I'm going to go ahead and do that right now. But it's a little bit hotter in here. Fans are waving. So it's a first world problem. I apologize. And it was just a hot week this past week. All right? All right. Thank you for that intermission of hydration. All right. So over the past 7 weeks, we've been going through 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. And we start off in May with this series called Runners on Your Mark. It's just basically preparation for the series that we're in now, which is Run Your Race. The Apostle Paul compares the faith, the living your life for God, like a race. And a race can be fun. There is a lot of hard work that goes into preparing for a race, but if you're going to get into anything like a race, anything that is hard work, there is probably a reason for it. You probably enjoy it for some reason. And you might be that odd one who enjoys things that everyone else doesn't. And you're like, I really like to do this. This is a joy for me. And everybody else is like, you're weird. But whatever it is, there are these moments where it should be a joy. And so running the race of life, living out our faith should be a joy. Week one, we talked about how God gives us gifts and talents so that we can use them to glorify Jesus. Ephesians 2:10, for we are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. After we give our heart to Jesus, we are then supposed to give all our gifts and our talents in service for Jesus, to glorify Jesus. Last week, Pastor Dave was in the pulpit as I was out of town. I thank you so much, Pastor Dave, wherever you're at. But he opened up God's word, Luke chapter 14, verses 25 through 34, the words of Jesus communicating to us as runners for Jesus that we need to sometimes make sacrifices, that being an authentic runner, follower of Jesus, will take sacrifice. Today, The last message in this two-part series that we started back in May, it's called Run Your Race with Freedom. With freedom. A lot of times as believers, we add weight back onto our lives that we're supposed to give to Jesus, leave with Jesus, but we for some reason go back, we pick it up. So we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 26, the one main passage that we've been in the past 7 weeks. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like a person running aimlessly. I do not fight like a person beating the air. Running. Running is just one of the things, if you're fortunate enough, God blesses you to be able to run. I remember as a little kid, it was just fun, right? Whatever it was, because we just ran all over the place. All right. I grew up in this ginormous town. It's just like one over called Weberville. If you haven't been there, there's so much to do there. So because there's so much to do, we would run around, we would play games, we would play football, basketball, baseball. There's this thing we called Running Man, and we'd just go run around, and all the kids from all over the town, we just play this massive game of tag and running. It was fun. There are these things in life, like running, that start off a joy. And at some moment in life, those things that we love to do start to feel like work. It starts to drain you. And for me, I still run, but I enjoy it less. And I'm not going to say just because I'm getting older. I want to say no. Like, I want to figure out how to stay as young as I can for as long as I can. But there's a moment, like, there's a moment that everything that we do in life, at some point in time, will start to feel like a drain. It'll start to feel like work. And so thinking about running the race, how can we run the race and keep that freedom? As believers, how can we keep that freedom, that first joy when we come to know Jesus and we say, Jesus, man, this is it. I've never felt this free before. No matter what you've done, any mistake that you've ever made, he knows all of them. And you can experience that freedom of being made new, totally forgiven, that freedom, that weight lifted. How do we keep that freedom when running the race? Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Verse 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, it's a direct reference to what the author is talking about in chapter 11. In chapter 11, there's this like hall of fame, like hall of the heroes of the faith, like these champions of the faith, champions in the Lord. In chapter 11, it's a direct reference. We have this cloud of witnesses. We have these moments where we can look and see that there are people who have gone through this before. God's word gives us a list of people to encourage us, a list of people that have ran the race. It lets us know that we're not the first ones to struggle. Think about that one thing that might right now, that one thing that might be that drain. Maybe it's something that it is a drain. Maybe it's something that there is weight to it. You need to let it go. But maybe there's something that is a joy and it somehow, for some reason, has become a drain. Whatever that is, you're not the first one to struggle with it. We're not the first ones to have been tested. We're not the first ones to have grown weary just by waking up day in and day out, living for God, living for the faith, running the race. We're not the first ones to get off track. The author points this out by simply mentioning that we have a cloud of witnesses. There's so much power in seeing, knowing that others have went through tough times, have dealt with difficult things, have made it through. Their witness is an encouragement. Looking up to those people that have been through it before help us to run our race with freedom. First thing, if you're a note taker, I want you to get that pen, paper out. If you're a person that uses their phone, grab your phone. If you're someone who's on that next level who wants to disconnect from the internet and you have a remarkable two, you are awesome. Get that out, okay? And I'm going to go ahead. That is like we were sponsored by something, Remarkable 2. Remarkable 2, sponsor us. Please give us a whole bunch of those. And then we'll fill everyone with those. So take notes right here. Make a list of names, your own list of heroes of the faith. When you look at Scripture, when you open up God's Word, Jesus, number one, absolutely. We should always be encouraged just by looking and thinking about the cross. But after that, who encourages you when you open up God's Word? For me, King David. For me, Moses. Right? Who are those people in God's Word that encourages you when you're going through difficult times? Heroes in the faith outside of the Bible that are out, also outside of your reach. Those who have gone on to be with the Lord or maybe not. My list right now of someone who is outside my reach that someone put on my radar, and I'm not even sure if I know how to say the person's last name. So my basketball people, I love basketball. I just don't watch basketball enough anymore. But Boston Celtics coach Joe, how do you say his last? Joel, how do you say? Connor, how do you say his last name? Mazzulla? What is it? Mazzulla. Anybody else knew that and I didn't? Okay, good. You just don't want to, you're afraid people are going to see your sweaty armpits. No, I'm just kidding. All right. So this dude is an absolute champion. He's outside of my reach, but I started paying attention because a friend, Kyle, he told me I should be paying attention to this guy. And if you have time, look up how he responds to reporters and how he lives out his faith in this, in the world stage. Amazing dude. Eric Thomas, a person who grew up in Detroit. He has ties with MSU and in Lansing. He's the number one motivational speaker in the world. He's way outside my reach, but I pay attention to him. And then an author, A.W. Tozer. Tozer is someone who I love to read. So there are these people that we can go ahead and we can refer to that are outside of reach, that are heroes of the faith. The last people on your list. So you're making a list of names. Those who are you see directly in God's Word, and then those who are outside of God's Word that are out of your reach. Those people who are in your reach. This group might be the most important. Those people that day in and day out, you can see the impact that they have on your life. I don't see him today, but one of those people is Pastor Dave for me. Pastor Dave, he is an absolute hero in the faith for me. I can call him at any time. I can ask him anything, and he'll answer the phone. He'll come to that call, and he'll go ahead, and he'll be there for me. And when we get done with these conversations, he'll always say, "Has this been helpful to you?" And I'm like, "Yes." There's another man of God that I've been connecting with. His name's Brian Williams, and he'll do the same thing. We'll get done or getting close to the end of the conversation. We'll say, "Does that help at all?" And he's usually on the phone because we don't meet face-to-face. And the whole time, I'm just like jotting down things, just writing. And I'm like, "Yeah, that's helpful, buddy. Like, keep it coming, okay?" Last person for me, a hero of the faith, my father-in-law. My father-in-law, he is not a man of many words, but his life is so Christ-like. His example of a husband, his example as a father is something that I observe and am encouraged by so often. See, I've made a lot of mistakes, many mistakes, and I wasn't the person that you would have eating at your dinner table, let alone marry your daughter. And I married his daughter. And I was a test suite. I've never been that sweet, especially back then. And I remember him just welcoming me in like a member of the family. Grace, unconditional love. There are these people, when we are going through difficult times and we like, I don't know how to get through this, we go to this list of names. So this is why I want you to make this list. When you go through something, refer back to this list. And for those people who are in your circle of life, when you have questions, when you're going through something difficult, I imagine if you just simply ask, they would be there. That's part of the reason we run with so much weight, so much baggage, is because we're afraid to ask anybody for help. Or we'd be like, I'm just going to go ahead and I'm just going to work harder. I'm going to work more often. I'm going to just do everything that I can, and I'm not going to ask for any help, and I'll figure it out. How often would the things that we go through be so much more easier to deal with if we just simply let our pride go and say, can you help me with this? It would allow us to run more freely in our faith. I'm also having you do this because we can get to that point that the things that we're dealing with, they're weighing us down so much that we will start to believe these two lies. That no one cares about what I'm going through, that no one understands what I'm going through. I won't make you raise your hands, but those two lies. Think about if you've ever thought those to be true. Where you felt like the world, everybody, has turned their back on you. That you're going through something that no one understands. And if you were to ask anybody, you have fear of them saying, I don't care. It's one of the greatest tactics of the enemy, is that he would isolate us and then just beat us down. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 says, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. The truth is, everything that you've ever gone through, that you will go through, someone has already gone through. They understand. And more people care than you realize. Now, I'm a firm believer in this. There might be different degrees of difficulties from generation to generation. Like, there are a lot of things that this younger generation is facing now that is more difficult than past generations. Absolutely, because the technology and some of those things, absolutely more difficult. My older generations, please do not be offended, and please take this to heart. There are things that they struggle with that you don't understand that way. And young people understand this, that those generations, those people that have come before you, they have dealt with things that you have no clue about. But all of us, to whatever degree of difficulty is, there are other people who understand. There are those people who understand. Hebrews chapter 12, still in verse 1, it says, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. This is your race, and this is your grace. There's a huge difference, and we will get this mixed up. There's a huge difference between receiving something and achieving something. We receive freedom, grace, salvation. We do not achieve it. As Christians and as we live in the United States, sometimes we think we have to work harder to receive or achieve. But receiving is just, it's a gift. Receiving salvation by the blood of Jesus, we receive forgiveness and freedom. At the cross is where Jesus died for our burdens. At the cross is where we leave our burdens. And not just those things that are difficult that we're dealing with, that the world's bringing onto us, but our mistakes. Again, the text says that hinders, and the sin that so easily entangles. God says, it says, all those things that you're dealing with, I understand. I died on the cross. I know the human problem, sin, a sinful heart, sinful nature, selfishness, all those things that create this the horrible parts of humanity. Jesus says, but I also created all the beautiful things of humanity. And let me take all the bad. Just leave it there with me and receive freedom, grace, love. Leave your sin and receive a life that is so much better than your sin. Achieving is to work for something, and there's nothing that we can do to earn our salvation. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, it says, for it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Trying to achieve, trying to earn your salvation causes people to perform for the world instead of being transformed by the work of the Holy Spirit. Huge difference. The difference is, if there are things going on inside of us that are not of God, what we'll do is we'll go ahead and we'll put on a mask, we'll pretend that we're not struggling with something, or we'll pretend that we're perfect, and we'll go ahead and we'll be fake. But the reality is, like, there's something going on in each and every single one of us. And the reason is because we have an enemy. And also the reason is because you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are a problem for the enemy. And freedom in Christ, that freedom to run the race the way that God calls you to, oh, enemy wants to stop that. And this is something I was thinking about, the pressure to perform. Pressure causes us not to experience the freedom of being united with Jesus. When running our race, we must understand that life is not about being the best. I'm going to say that again. I listened to a motivational speaker. I just said that. I listened to a motivational speaker to encourage me, and a lot of times it's all about being the best. The world tells us it's all about being the best, meaning that it's all about you. But in reality, it's about using the best of what God has placed in you to glorify Him. When we get in the habit of trying to be the best and to be great, then the enemy will start to blur that line of who is it for? Is it for you or is it for Jesus? That freedom to run the race, the freedom of just saying, I'm going to go ahead and do whatever you call me to the best of my abilities based upon the gifts and the talents that you've given me. And when I'm done, I can leave it there and I cannot worry about it. And I'm preaching to the choir here. We had yesterday the parade. Tim, thank you for letting me ride your one wheel while you rode Andy's. But later that night, like my actions, like I was like, did I operate as a lead pastor properly in the parade? Because all I did was just ride a one wheel around circles around the float and Paul's scout. I just kept on running, you know, races, like, circles on this one wheel. I'm just like, it's going around. I'm like, waving, trying not to fall and look like an idiot in front of the whole town on this one wheel. One wheel, if you don't know what a one wheel is, because I know some people don't, it's a skateboard with a motor and a big wheel right in the center of it. Just like that. You just lean, it just goes. But later that night, think about that. Like later that night, this is the way that the enemy attacked me. He's like, oh, that wasn't how you're supposed to act as a lead pastor. That's kind of childish. That's kind of this. And now all of a sudden, I just wanted to be me. I wanted to have fun. I wanted to have fun. All of a sudden, like, I should have just left it there, say, that's what I did. We had a blast. God was glorified. One person who doesn't come to church here, a kid's already signed up for VBS. Like, praise God. But all of a sudden, I'm thinking about what others think about my actions when there was nothing to worry about. So the idea of being the best, I just want to do the best that I can and then leave it at that. Jesus said, if anyone wants to be great, they must be a servant. So if God has placed you in a position of being great, absolutely be great. And to be the greatest, absolutely do that. But do that in service to the Lord and to others. So thinking about this moment of the human condition, sin, the problem that none of us can fix. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The penalty we can't pay. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. No other person has the ability to lay down their life and then raise it back up. No one has the ability to forgive our sins but Jesus. Only God in the flesh. Hebrews again, chapter 12, verse 2 says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Part of being able to run this race with freedom is sit in the presence of the Lord. Navigators 2:7, as you heard them talking about that, that's sitting in the presence of the Lord, memorizing scripture, journaling, praying, all those things. Us coming here and worshiping, that's being in the presence of the Lord. But when we leave this place, it can't stop. We have to continue to be in the presence of the Lord. Being in the presence of something causes you to change. The longer that I'm in here, in this heat, with these lights, my body will continue to change and you'll start to see my knees sweat. Just the way it is. Yesterday, for all those people who were out in the heat yesterday, it changed what your clothing was like. It went from dry to wet. It just kind of happens. If you know this young man who is a champion in the Lord, and he's not here right now, but this is his family's right here, Caleb Clendenin. Caleb, if you watch this one day, I'm clowning on you a little bit, but I'm also serious. Caleb Clendenin, he's down there in Tennessee. He's not supposed to talk with the Southern drawl. He's not. He is Michigan as it gets, but he's spent one too many weeks down there, so this most recent Marco Polo, all of a sudden he's like got the Southern drawl. I'm like, where did that come from in just one week? If you spend time in the presence of other people and things, it will change you. You spend time in the presence of the Lord, it will change you. So scripture says we're supposed to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. If we want to run the race and run it with freedom, we have to keep our eyes on the prize. The main thing being the main thing. And what happens is we start to slowly get off track. We are drawn to sin in our moments of weakness and loneliness when we take our eyes off of Jesus and focus on something else. So my question is today, is how are you feeling with your race? How are you feeling with a weight that you carry or you don't carry? The burdens of life. The physical, the financial, the spiritual. Loss of a loved one. Frustration in life because the things that you used to enjoy are now draining. Like, where are you at in your race? Are you experiencing the freedom by keeping your eyes fixed on Jesus? I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to invite the worship team back up. And the last thing that I want to mention for us running the race and running in a way where we can be free is that the thing that we do for God can't be more important than God. It can't. And I'll go ahead. Like, transparency is helpful for me. I think as a leader, I just like transparent. And then sometimes if I go a little too far, someone will tell me, check me. But the thing that has gotten me this past week and a half or so is that as a leader, I'm called to spend more time with God than more time talking about God. And I was on vacation, for a week spending time with family, and then I come back and there's this to-do list, and I'm like chasing after time with the Lord. I'm chasing it. I'm trying to find the time to do it, and all of a sudden it's just like, there's something wrong this past week. Like, what is wrong? My time with the Lord has been radically reduced because I didn't make it a priority. I turned around making the things of ministry a priority versus my relationship with God a priority. Come on, everyone can do this. It can happen to anybody. The way that you fix it, though, is fixing your eyes on Jesus. Whatever you have to do, whatever that moment is, saying no to whatever it is, even if it's good things, even if it's godly kingdom work, and saying yes to that alone time with Jesus, you got to do it. And you got to grab a hold of anybody that you need to help you with it. So before I hand it over to Amber and the worship team, I want to say that we're a church that loves Jesus, makes disciples, and serves our community. But we also want to be a church that creates a culture of helping you take that next step in your faith, whatever it is. Maybe you haven't been baptized yet. Maybe you need to go public with your faith. Maybe God's calling you to be a teacher. Maybe God's calling you to set your pride aside and ask for help. Maybe it's time for you to say no to whatever it is and yes to your alone time with Jesus. Maybe it's, we've been in these past two series, one of the things that we want to do is we want to give you an opportunity to serve. Maybe God's calling you to serve in some way, shape, or form, to use your gifts and your talents. And so if you were to go online and just Google williamstonchurch.org, it's up there, and you go ahead and you go to the top right, there's a tab, you click on it, there's a drop down, you click on ministries, and then below that there'll be a moment where it says serve WFMC. And if you want to get in a spot where you want to serve the Lord, because maybe that's the moment of, like, you're just so, like, needing to publicly do things for your faith and with your faith, we want to help you with that. We want to help you if you're the person who says, I resonate with some of those things, Pastor Alan, and I need help. That's what we're here for. Nobody's going to push you aside. Nobody's going to say, that's dumb. Nobody's going to look at you like, I can't help you. I don't care. Like, you're alone. Like, all the opposite. We care. You're not alone. How can we pray? How can we help? So as the worship team leads this last song, where are you at in your race? How is your freedom feeling? Is it not there? Or is God working? And you'll just praise God during this next song.
As we sing, I just hope that this is another opportunity for you to fix your eyes on Him this morning and to remember why we put our trust in Him.
Never fail.
mission. All is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song.
Wonderful day, church. Thank you for being here. Keep trusting in Him.